It should be shown to teenagers. And in France, actually, it's going to be shown to teenagers in schools. There is a program in Brittany that will show the film to the pupils. And I think that it is very important because, as I often say, when you say to a teenager, don't do that, the only thing that he wants to do is to do exactly the contrary that you're telling him. So, but if you give him the choice to think and to talk with his friends, and I think it's a better way to educate young teenagers. We tried to go back as much as possible in our own feelings when we were teenagers, and I think that when a film goes that deeply into sincere things, things that you feel, then it becomes, in a way, universal, and it touches more the people of today or yesterday or in the future, I think. It's true that we try to make a cinema that is close to sensation. We like to feel the wind, to feel the sand on the beach, and we are always trying to go as close as possible to our feelings and sensations. And sometimes we even do a kind of organic cinema, or we try to. And it's also true that therefore we take risks. But I mean, you know, if you don't take risks for a first film, then for us it's not really worth it. If it's to do what you have seen and do always the same thing, then I guess we should try more and more things. Sometimes we fail, but it's a part of the game, I should say. As compared to other French productions, I don't know really. We have people like Céline Sciamma, for example, that I think we feel very close to her. I don't know if she feels close to us, but we feel close to her in a way that she goes very deeply into the sensations too, and also close to the characters without any psychological judgments or so in that way we feel close to those directors.
Sì, tanto per cambiare.
Da quanto lo sai?
5 giorni. Ma sono di 8 settimane.
5 giorni? Perché non ci hai detto niente?
Hai aspettato così tanto?
Non ci credevo.
Ne hai parlato con tua madre?
Sono abbastanza grande per decidere da sola.
Un bel guaio.
Ah, sì.
Non vorrei abortire.
Preferisci che lo tenga e che lasci il liceo? Vuoi che sparisca, che faccia il bambino e si trovi un lavoro di merda?
Non lo so.
Aspetta un attimo, non ho ancora deciso.
Lo senti già muovere?
No. Ma sicuramente qualcosa è cambiato. Non potete capire quanto mi sento strana.
Our producer was a real luck to her, to us. Mm-hmm. It's been a great encounter, and in France he's probably one of the most, even maybe the most talented producer. He is of course the producer of the Dardenne Brothers, but not only, also of Pascal Ferrand, Lady Châtelet, and Ursula Meyer. Mm-hmm. So for us to be with him on our first film was a real lucky thing. And indeed, he is not said to be the best producer just like that. In everyday work, from the scenario to the end of the editing and mixing, is always present. And it's a luxury to work with him because, for example, when we ask for the girls to have 3 weeks rehearsals in Brittany, in the sets where we were going to shoot, he said yes. And for us, that's a real luxury for production because it means that those 17 girls that didn't know each other at the beginning at all, after 3 weeks they became friends, and then for us the work was much more easy. And also in the writing of the scenario, he says very few things, but they are very accurate. And indeed, he's a great producer, and we thank him every day. What was very important for us is to choose them according to the characters. The film is very written, and there was very little place for improvisation. So we had to find them very close to the character. That was the first thing. Then, of course, they had to be very good actresses. And then, maybe more important of all, they had to get on well with each other. Because at first, when we put them all together in a room for the first meeting, they looked at each other like they were not friends. And of course, when you are teenagers, you have a way to look at each other, you have a way to behave, to touch each other, and this we had to build because it was not natural. So this was the 3 weeks rehearsal with the actresses. And then it's difficult to work with teenagers in a way that you have to be very kind, and sometimes you have to be harsh. It's exactly like education, I guess. It's a kind of, I don't know, alchemy. Today it worked very well because 3 of them are living in the same flat, so that worked. It was very important, the set, but also because it was from experience. Lorient, the town where we put the film in, is a town that was completely destructed during the Second World War and reconstructed very geometrically, and it's a grey city. And at the same time, each weekend you go with your parents to the beach and you see the horizon. And also you know that Lorient was a town where all the ships went to India to bring back spices and gold, you know, in the ancient times. So you know all that historically and geographically. There is a tension between what you see today of Lorient as a town, you know, not very good in industry, or I mean declining, and the fact that you see boats going away, you see the horizon all the time, and you feel that there is something else possible, another life possible. And the tension that it creates, it gives you sometimes frustration, but also the feeling that you could do something else of your life. And this was very strong when we were teenagers, the fact that we were trapped in the city, but we would hope something different. We would like to travel, to work in the cinema. All that was from our hopes when we were there, and we tried to put that today in the film and with those girls. But this is the dream of motherhood is fundamental, and I would say more than that, even because this is the collective pregnancy in a way. And it's the fact that, you know, they would have some kind of collective womb. This is the dream of it, and of course this is from our part, this is why the project fails, because of course a pregnancy is definitely individual, and they thought that it could be collective. But like you mentioned, the liquid, that is around them, and in which, in a way, they feel that they could build a new world, was in our idea from the beginning. although we didn't want to go too much into symbolic you know, feature, because it is a real fact at the beginning. So we tried to match as well as possible the reality and also the symbolic things, and we must say a kind of fairy tale in a way, because when we say 17 girls, it was like we were saying once upon a time there were 17 princesses. So, you know, we always oscillate between this very realistic kind of movie in a grey city and the pink fairy tale, I would say.
Mi ha fatto paura.
Non vuoi scopare con me?
Cosa? Non se ne parla. Credi che non lo sappia che cercate tutte di fare un bambino?
E se ti do 20 euro se ne parla?
Tu sei matta, non ci penso proprio.
30? Cinquanta?
I've never been pregnant, but you know, in every day I talk with my sister, just talked to her 5 minutes ago, and she states that it is a kind of thing where you are in between two states. She says sometimes, of course, it's reality and I can feel it, and at the same time it's completely unbelievable to say that you have somebody else in your body. You have to think and say, okay, this is what I'm feeling now, it's because of that. And she says it's an everyday statement. So I think it's part of the foundation of the film, the foundation of pregnancy, is that at the same time it's very real, and on the same level, it's completely unbelievable. Like, you know, we could say, but this is an everyday statement, that the miracle of life, but when you realize it, it's life, and at the same time seems a miracle. So we always are in between those two things, but then I think they are part of the incredible state of pregnancy. Well, in, you know, in teenage time, I think that you always are in between those states. You know, when you are with your friends, you are laughing all the time, and you know, all you want to think about is have fun and be with friends, go to parties. And at the same time, when you feel, when you go back to your room at your parents, you can be totally desperate and totally anxious about what's going to happen in your future life. So we remember there again of those two states where at the same time you can be very happy and the next moment totally desperate because somebody, you know, your boyfriend sends you a bad message or whatever, you can jump out of the window. So I guess that at the special time of the teenage time, all the feelings are totally exacerbated, and that's why also it's difficult to for the parents to educate you, because you can be so extreme in your feelings and sensations. So in the film we wanted also to translate this kind of feeling where everything is extreme always. I mean, we were like that. I don't know, maybe some teenagers are more, you know, today more moderate, but we were very passionate. It's a matter of point of view. You know, the film is called 17 Girls, and we wanted to be in the eyes, in the bodies of the 17 girls. And therefore, the male are in the background. But that doesn't mean that they are not important. For example, the brother of Camille, the protagonist, is for us the alter ego of Camille, and he is not less important. He is the exact male figure in mirror of Camille. But you know, to treat 17 characters is very difficult. So male and adults are in the background, but that doesn't mean for us that we neglect them. They are for us, of course, they are important, but we couldn't make a 4-hour film, so we had to choose. For us, we like when everything is mixed. And you know, now I have a little bit experience of both documentaries and fiction, and I notice now that in documentaries sometimes you have to set things. For example, you say to the character, okay, you go from there to there. And this is not documentary, because in real life he wouldn't have gone from there to there. But you ask him, and in a way, it's mise-en-scène. And on the contrary, in our fiction, sometimes, you know, the girls, we told them, of course, to play the scenario. But there were very little things when they were very at ease with us that were documentary, because they were touching each other in a way, they were behaving in a way, they were looking at each other in a way. And all that was documentary, because it was those actresses at that moment, at that age, doing such thing, and this is purely documentary. So, you know, you have both, and what I like is when this is mixed. Because when it's too fake in a fiction, I see it. And on the contrary, in a documentary, when it's too, you know, live, I mean, running after somebody without any, you know, real cinematography, then I don't like that either. So I like when it's mixed. So that's what we did. For example, you know, when the girls are in their rooms, it's the real girls in the real rooms. And we didn't change anything. One day, you know, you push the door, you enter a girl's room, and it's completely pink or completely dedicated to Marlon Brando or Marilyn Monroe. And then you don't change anything, because the reality is so beautiful like that, that you keep it. It was a long, long work, and for us it was very important that, because the film was also in a way a kind of a rebellion, we wanted to have a rock music, you know, not those kind of sweet things that we don't like. And also what was important for us, it was we wanted it to be contemporary. We wanted the girls to listen also, or to be able to listen to this music, and not put our taste of, you know, 40 or around 40 years old women. We wanted to to have a very contemporary songs, and if possible, female rock songs. So we listened to thousands of tracks, and at the end, and also the lyrics are quite important. You know, it's difficult sometimes in films. The music is fantastic, but the lyrics don't go at all with the film, and in a way, you step out of it. So we carefully listen to thousands of things, and then I think, you know, like Blood Red Shoes or Easy On Air, we couldn't change it now, it's part of the film. Actually, it's really 50-50, in a way that, you know, people think that because she's a writer and I'm a cinematographer, she should write the scenario and I should do the camera, but in fact it's not like this at all. We do the writing 50-50, we share the same computer, we write on the same computer, and directing with the same, and at the camera, of course, sometimes I look more at the technical things because this was my previous job, but sometimes she takes the camera and she dares doing things that maybe I wouldn't do because I'm more aware of technical things, and sometimes it's very lucky, you know, and so we share nearly everything, but we've been very close to each other since we are young. We share the same flat, or we used to share the same flat, and so there's no real problem with that.